The UK says the Russian plane that crashed in Egypt may well have been brought down by an explosive device. CBS News senior national security analyst Juan Zarate is on the phone and joins me now. Juan, putting aside ISIS's claim for taking this plane down, who else would have a motive for attacking this plane if it turns out there was an explosive device on it?
Well, Vlad, we still don't know for sure. The British are saying this it could have been an explosive device. Most experts are suggesting there was some sort of explosion on the plane, so we've got to be cautious here. That said, you're right. There are those who might be motivated to go after the Russians. The Russians have been engaged in all sorts of fighting and wars, including in Chechnya for some time. They've had a number of attacks, including on aircraft in Russia by Chechen groups in Dagestan. And there are a number of extremists that have Russia as target number one. And so aside from ISIS, there could be a number of al-Qaeda-like affiliates or individuals who would be willing to go after a Russian target like this, a civilian aircraft. But what we're seeing now, Vlad, is additional audio, it appears, from the ISIS affiliate in the Sinai, again, claiming responsibility. And in many ways, they have the environment and the opportunity to potentially have done this, and it makes them certainly a suspect in potentially having brought down this plane.
And Juan, now let's take it a step back, and as you say, we're still trying to figure out exactly, I know investigators are still doing that. The first question is sort of a two-part question. One, could the UK perhaps have jumped the gun, or they know something that perhaps US officials, Russian officials, Egyptian officials do not know? And now let's take it back, and if it turns out that it is ISIS, what does that mean?
Well, big questions there. I think in the first instance, the UK, the US, the Egyptians all would probably be tracking the same information, the forensics, what's coming out of the search for the black box information to give them more details as to what was happening in flight in the sequence. And so it's not clear to me that the British would actually have more or additional information to give them fidelity around what happened. That said, you know, the British have to be cautious. There are a number, thousands of British citizens who travel to Sharm el-Sheikh and to the region for tourism. They're cautioning around the holiday travel season. And so I think they're trying to be as cautious as possible. And what you read from 10 Downing Street is the possibility that it was an explosive device, nothing definitive yet. And certainly it's a bit of speculation mixed in, but it certainly is a real possibility. And I think the British government wants to be as cautious as possible, which is why they've put out that statement. In terms of if this is really ISIS and if this is really an explosive device that brought down the plane, this is a game changer because it demonstrates that ISIS has the capability to operate and to terrorize and to execute a very tragic and significant attack well beyond Syria and Iraq, that their affiliates, like the one in the Sinai, can actually execute against a foreign target, can attack foreign civilians, and it significantly can put aircraft in jeopardy, that this isn't just the province of sophisticated actors like the sophisticated bomb maker from al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, whom we've been worried about, that this is a technology and a threat that has proliferated and now impacts the ISIS universe. It also, Vlad, makes very clear that the ISIS threat, again, not just being a threat from Iraq and Syria, really has metastasized, that this moves beyond the mere sort of labeling or carrying of the banner of this group, that these are groups that are willing to attack foreign targets from territory like the Sinai. And so it's really a game changer if it turns out to be the case. God forbid if that's the case, but it will add urgency to the need to go after ISIS in all of its manifestations.
And to that point, Juan, about the manifestations of ISIS, as you point out, it is unlike al-Qaeda in that it has so far been reported, at least, that ISIS is very decentralized. There is no one particular leader. So in a case like this, if it turns out, and again, we're cautioning that this is just from preliminary reporting from the UK, but if it turns out that there was some type of an explosive device on this aircraft, I mean, just in terms of the intelligence gathering and the war on terror that all other nations are conducting, what does it mean if one sort of Hydra head of ISIS can do something like this, and then you have a whole completely different situation happening in Syria and another one happening in Iraq. What does that mean for combating them?
Well, I think it, if it's true, and again, we don't want to jump to conclusions, but if it is true, it is the end of the orthodoxy that this is a group that is simply focused on maintaining territory and control in Iraq and Syria. I think we've comforted ourselves with the orthodoxy that you can divide groups between those that are most interested in their local situations, most interested in local control. And then there are those like Al-Qaeda Central that are more worried about hitting Western targets. And this is something I've talked about a lot, Vlad. You know this. The jihadi and global groups of today are a mix, and they very much have embedded in them the global jihadi DNA of attacking not just local security services and not just establishing local caliphates, but also continuing to attack the West wherever and however they can. And I think that will, you know, if this is the case in Sinai, it will certainly reorient our counterterrorism policy to reorient it toward a global approach, because ISIS has a presence in the Sinai, it has a presence in Libya, it has gained the allegiance of Boko Haram in West Africa, it's gaining adherence in the Gulf in places like Yemen, Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, it's gaining adherence in Central Asia, including Afghanistan, and even in parts of Southeast Asia. And so this really does become a much more clear and manifest global problem, and it's another huge headache for counterterrorism and security officials.
Juan, this is sort of another question to the question of headache. Is it a headache for Al-Qaeda? In other words, I'm wondering, does Al-Qaeda need to do something, or do they need to ramp up their terror activities in an effort to compete against ISIS? Because we know that the two have not always seen eye to eye when it comes to some of these activities.
It's a great question. I there's some debate among the analytic community that looks at this question. I think the answer is yes and no. I think yes in the sense that Al-Qaeda and ISIS in many ways are in a strategic battle over defining where this global terrorist movement is going and what it means actually to be a part of that movement. And so in some ways, yes, Al-Qaeda has to maintain some degree of prominence, demonstrate capability, and continue to prove that it can do things, whether it's locally in places like Afghanistan, Pakistan, where they're present, or in Syria, where they have some territory, or even with foreign operatives. And so, yes, counterterrorism officials have to be worried that Al-Qaeda will want to demonstrate its relevance still and may launch an attack. And so officials and counterterrorism experts will look for that. The no answer here is that in many ways, though, there is a strategic competition underway. The interests and, in some ways, the methodologies and opportunities align for ISIS and Al-Qaeda. And so in places where they may not be in competition, like Syria, they may find common cause and common interests, perhaps like in the Sinai or in places like Yemen, where they may not be at war with each other yet. And so the danger here is that you have not just Al-Qaeda and ISIS in competition, but you may have them cooperating in certain instances. And I think that's a real danger, because ISIS then piggybacks off of what Al-Qaeda has built, and Al-Qaeda is able to piggyback off of ISIS's territorial control and momentum.
Juan Zarate with analysis for us. Juan, thank you very much.
Thank you, Vlad.